group on the road, they could visit your house. There's a sign-up sheet available. Charlie Crook and Ruthie Cranton.
Inside of me that is only filled by you. You're the treasure of my life. There's a thousand reasons why
I could never say goodbye.
I remember lonely, restless days, going nowhere like a ship upon the bottle. Then your gentle voice whispered to my soul, now love has let me know I'm home at last. Oh Lord,
I could never say goodbye when I need you like I do. There's an empty space inside me that is
you're the treasure of my life. There's a thousand reasons why I could never say goodbye.
Once I thought that love was just a dream, but I can't deny this miracle that's found me. Whoa, no. From this moment on, you're the only one I'll ever need. You're the one, my Lord,
and I know you'll never let me go. I'll never let you go away. You're the treasure of my life. There's a thousand reasons why
with Baker's Place in Boston.
Strange, what tips the scales of justice or injustice? Mine was the power to save that wandering prophet Jesus. No guilt could I find in the man. Was he trying me or him, I wondered? Yes, I had the power. Governor of Judea, Roman soldier, emissary of Caesar. But how could I? How could anyone?
Crucify him!
I can still hear the drunken, deafening rage of that mob. I can see their dirty, shaking fists.
Crucify him!
Only a fortnight ago, and I still see their bleary eyes screaming for his death. Ruffians, heirlings of Caiaphas, paid to demand the blood of Jesus. What did they care whose blood was spilled? Hurry up and get it over so we can go and get our black strap. How I hated that Caiaphas. Jealous viper, feeling his power slipping because of the teachings of this prophet. Ever since I was sent over from Rome to govern this poor province, I have detested Caiaphas and his senile father-in-law, Annas. I had the authority to save this guiltless man, but most of all, it was for Claudia I wanted to save him.
You must not meddle with this innocent man. You will suffer longer than will he if you kill him. Please, I beg of you, deal with him in a righteous way.
She did have a dream. When she first spoke of it, I gave it a little thought. She had never wanted to anger the gods in Rome, but to deny Claudia her slightest wish was inconceivable. She, raised in Roman affluence, her grandfather a close friend of Caesar's. A fortnight ago, now she refuses to share my bed. How little I knew what was ahead. Sentencing culprits was routine. I was the final authority over the Sanhedrin. After the Sanhedrin had tried them, we have to make an example of them or the country would run riot. Sending those other two, Gesmus and Dismas, who slew, stripped, and robbed would be no problem. But this man from Nazareth, this prophet...
He blasphemed!
By whose authority did this man drive the money changers from the temple?
He healed the sick on the Sabbath.
Crucify him! Crucify him!
An impostor who spreads sedition.
His followers call him King of the Jews.
He stirs up the people.
Crucify him!
Crucify him!
Crucify him! Crucify him!
What a night. I had to wait up to pass the final sentence. I kept wondering what was keeping them. I sent my runner and learned that two of the judges were trying to save Jesus. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus.
The case has collapsed. Nothing has been proven.
What if he did say he was the Messiah?
Can we disprove it?
It's not blasphemy.
But they were outnumbered, and Jesus was brought before me. It was plain to see that he had been brutally mistreated. Bruises, blood, a swollen eye, a fine-looking man, wavy brown hair and kindly eyes. Are you a king, I asked?
My kingdom is not of this world. To this end I was born, and for this reason came I into the world to bear witness to the truth.
Crucify
him!
Crucify
him! He preaches sedition throughout Judea, from Galilee to here!
Crucify him!
Crucify him!
Crucify him!
Galilee? Ha! Then it was not my problem, it was Herod's. Take him to Herod, I ordered. No doubt the blood of another prophet was too recently on his conscience. Carousing as usual, Herod only taunted him.
Show us your tricks, magician. Come on, perform for us. Let's have some miracles.
While I waited for the verdict, Claudia came to me again.
It would be unthinkable to kill this man.
Did she think I wanted to? Why couldn't she realize what an explosive situation it was for me? How could I explain that the soldier of Caesar's had assisted in the arrest and had not confirmed the sentence? One complaint to Rome and I would lose my imperial position. Caiaphas, crafty fox, knew this. He had planned it carefully. Jesus was returned to me. Once more, calm in the midst of that howling mob, he faced me. Why didn't he rebel? He didn't even cringe. Or ask for mercy. It was almost as if he wanted to die. Didn't he know I had the power to save him? Then the thought struck me. It might be my way out. Surely the crowd wouldn't agree to release the murder of Barabbas. I held up my hand for silence. Who will I release to you, I said. Jesus or Barabbas? There was a moment's hesitation. Then with one accord.
Barabbas!
I couldn't believe my ears. I had failed again. The elders, scribes, and Pharisees coaching the mob had no intention of letting Jesus escape. Caiaphas had rehearsed them well.
Crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him!
Anyone who pretends to be a king is no friend of Caesar's.
Crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him!
If you let this man go, you're no friend of Caesar's.
Crucify him! Crucify him! Crucify him!
No friend of Caesar's? I couldn't afford that censorship. Treason! I would lose my position. Possibly my head. These fools had forced me. Fools who despise Caesar, yet were proclaiming no king but Caesar. What an influence the rattling of a few coins can make. The mob broke loose. Stripped him and flogged him and tossed a purple robe over his bleeding body and shouted,
Hail, King of the Jews!
There was no way out. Oh, I suppose I could have saved him, but saving him would have cost me my imperial position and possibly caused a revolution. I wish I could have saved him. I even wish I had known him. I asked for quiet and spoke to the crowd. I had called for a basin to wash my hands. Be sure you see what I am doing, I said to the crowd, so I shall be innocent of the blood of this just man. Caiaphas' plot had worked. He had won. Jesus was crucified. I did it for the sake of Rome. If only I could convince Claudia.
My Savior lives, yet my eyes witnessed his cruel death upon the cross. Why? How could it be? He who made the blind to see, healed the sick, gave hope to the disheartened. Why did his disciples forsake him, they who had sworn to follow him always? Where were you, Peter, when he needed you, you whom he named the rock? And Judas, what did you gain by betraying our Lord? And you, James and John, Thomas, Bartholomew, and the rest, why did you run away? Did he not teach you?
Going to all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. For lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world.
Did not even the executioner say?
Truly this man is a son of God.
And the Roman soldiers threw dice for his garment, the same seamless robe his mother had woven for him.
Forgive them. They know not what they do.
Always forgiving. He had come to save us. We who followed him knew he was our Savior. But so few listened. Did he have to be crucified to make men believe? So it seems. Only a fortnight ago, there he hung between those two thieves, a sign saying, Jesus, King of the Jews. A radiant glow shone about his head as a murky storm gathered. Lo, rolling thunder swelled into a tremendous crash as if the earth was being torn asunder. Those about the cross panicked and fled. Later, when his limp body was taken down, his mother gently cradled the limp body as she had done so often in his childhood. One of the respected judges of the temple, Joseph of Arimathea, had requested the body of Jesus, and he wrapped him in fine linens and laid him in a nearby tomb hewn of stone. Pilate dispatched guards to make certain of the closing of the tomb. On the third day, I returned to weep and pray, and suddenly became conscious that the stone had been rolled away. I stared in unbelief. It couldn't be. The grave was empty. I rushed back to tell the news. They have taken away our Lord.
Who? What can this mean?
No, how? You must have had a vision.
Come, let us see for ourselves.
As they were looking into the empty grave, I dropped to my knees, weeping. Suddenly I sensed a presence standing beside me.
Why weepest thou?
They have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him.
Mary.
Rabboni, it was my Savior, my teacher. It could be no other. I reached up to touch him.
Don't hold to me, for I have yet to ascend to my Father. But go to my brothers and tell them I am going to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.
I had seen my master. He had conquered death. But how? No one could believe. No one but our Lord's mother.
I believe you, my child. He is risen from the dead to ascend to his Father and our Father.
She suddenly seemed transfigured, strengthened, and young, almost as if she had risen from the dead with her son. If only I had her strength of mind. I feel so lost. I'll never forget that day in June when I first saw him. He was walking through a wheat field. I hailed him as he passed, but he did not turn his head. I hated him. When I had hailed men, they came to me. Yet my life was empty. My nights after that were sleepless. What was there about that man, I wondered? I learned that his name was Jesus, that he was a wandering prophet from Nazareth. I had heard stories and rumors about his miracles. Then, one day on a hillside, I sat nearby as he talked to his followers.
What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his soul? Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
He talked about God's love and the forgiveness of sin. I knew I wanted to feel God's love. I wanted his forgiveness.
I learned that Jesus was eating at a Pharisee's home that night, and I went there with perfumes to anoint his feet. Simon the host was angry with me.
If this man is a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of a woman she is. She is a sinner.
Simon, I came into your home and you gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You poured no oil on my head, but she poured perfume on my feet. That's why I tell you, Simon, that her sins are forgiven, many as they are. You see, she has loved much.
Who is this that should even forgive sins?
Then Jesus turned to me.
Your faith has saved you. Go in peace.
From that moment, I felt clean. My life had dignity and meaning, and I followed my Savior constantly after that, even unto the grave. But he is not dead. My Savior lives.
One seems unable to waken, so cruel. A Messiah to save men, yet he had to suffer agony to make men believe. Then, that third day after burial, Mary Magdalene burst into our home.
I have seen our Lord!
No one answered. The disciples and the women looked at one another. Their hearts were filled with fear and unbelief. Then John found words to question Mary.
When did you see him and where?
When you left the Master's grave, I stayed on alone, weeping for my Lord. A voice said, "Woman, why do you weep?" And I answered, "They have taken away my Lord." Then looking up, I saw the Master. I tell you, I saw the Master. He called me by name, told me not to touch him, for he had not yet ascended, but to go to my brethren and say to them, "I ascend to my Father, and to my God, and your God."
Mary, you are seeing spirits. We were at the tomb. Did not see him.
I tell you again, I have seen our Master.
I believe you, my child, I told her. I took her trembling body in my arms, and we wept together. Such a little while ago, a short 34 years, a voice spoke to me.
Blessed are you among women. You will conceive and bring forth a child, and his name shall be called Jesus.
I, a poor peasant girl in Nazareth, the small town looked down upon by the people in the city of Jerusalem. Why? How? I could not understand, but I trusted. And it was as the angel voice had said. Our son was beautiful and radiant, and as shepherds and wise men knelt before our newborn son in that lowly stable, I began to realize the miracle of his birth. Could our child be the Savior the people had been waiting for? A Savior. Our family life seemed so normal. Jesus romped with the other boys of his age. As a small child, he liked to pick up chips and shavings in Joseph's carpenter shop. As he grew older, he brought in firewood and delivered things that Joseph had made in his shop. Obedient and happy always, he even fashioned things almost as expertly as did Joseph. Yes, we were a happy family. We worked hard. Our modest means allowed only a pair of turtle doves to sacrifice at the temple. Jesus loved the Passover when we made our pilgrimage to Jerusalem. When he was 12, we missed him on our homeward journey. There were many of us traveling together, so we did not miss him for the first day or two. We were fearful that he had been lost as we hurried back to Jerusalem. We found him seated with his teachers at the temple. They were putting questions to him and were amazed with his knowledge. Joseph and I were angered that he had caused us so much anguish. "My son, why have you treated us like this?" I said. "Your father and I have been searching for you in great anxiety."
"Did you not know I am bound to be in my father's house?"
His father's house was no longer Joseph's house, I began to realize. Then later, after Joseph's death, Jesus was sitting at my side as I did my weaving. He looked at me. He did not speak for several minutes.
"Father, did you know my time is near at hand?"
Are you prepared?
I said, God will have his way. I never should have answered in such a way.
But God's will is my only crutch on this road. It should be yours, too.
I am only a weak woman.
A mother's weakness is her strength. Your weakness will purge Israel like the blood of a sin offering.
So young, I thought, yet the strength and authority of God's love and will were beginning to be manifest in him. You are my comfort, my son, I told him. He was soon wandering about the countryside, teaching the word of God. I rejoiced to hear of his healings and of the multitudes who followed him. He was a wondrous son, shoulders broadened by the years, voice full and deep. From the time he drove the money changers from the temple, I feared for his safety. And he knew his time on earth was short. He had gathered his disciples about him, and in those last 3 years, he spent every waking hour in teaching, healing, and prayer. Towards the end, he called his disciples to him.
My children, for a little longer I am with you. Then you will look for me, but where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment. Love one another as I have loved you. Set your troubled hearts at rest. Trust in God always. Trust also in me. There are many places in my Father's house, and I go to prepare a place for you.
I like to remember his words when he raised Lazarus. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he be dead, shall live. I like to think on those words as I see his dear face looking down on me as he died on the cross. Perhaps a mother's weakness is her strength. Yet I am not strong. If I were, so many questions would not flood my mind. The miracle of his birth, and how can his teaching spread to all mankind? He never traveled far, never wrote a book.
Mother, let not your heart be troubled. Trust in God and rejoice.
Trust in God and rejoice. Our next selection is a special guest to West Church. We'd like to welcome Billy Joel this evening. Billy Joel, would you come now?
Somehow I always picked the longest line. I went out to get some shopping done. There are things I'd rather do for fun. I never doubted the market would be crowded. I wound up standing in the longest line. Whoa. In the longest line, whoa, in the longest I'm that voice you're hearing in the mall, pushing slow pokes up against the wall. I'm at the checkout, now I can get the heck out, so I won't die here in the longest line. I had time to write down this song, but only because this line is so long. Now I know the woman who's in charge. If she was not so large, I would say what I'm thinking. I went in to close up my account. Should have let them keep the whole amount. 'Cause now I'm standing out on the here at the tail end of the longest line. I had second place in my line, but I didn't see the not open sign. Maybe I'm expecting too much, but I think they'd stay in touch with the people who pay them. I had business at the registry, just a masochistic tendency. To pay my fine debts, I'm waiting in the line that's waiting just to get into the longest line. Whoa, longest in the longest line. Whoa, in the longest line. Whoa.
Following Billy Joel, Lamb of God, Cara.
Your gift of love
with our first poem of the evening. Patricia?
As I felt the depth of my depravity, the lack of sacrifice, I was taken in. As I ran through the rooms of my being, the darkness surrounded me. I let myself not see. As the shadows came and went, the light would not shine. I let it break through, through, and through.
Next, leading in a spiritual dance, Abby Midwood.
A long time drifting back and forth as a Christian, fading into church, and just like David turned the microphone on, fading back out again. And it took a long time in my life to develop a real relationship, a serious relationship with Christ, one that was going to make a difference in my life and in my family's life, in the lives of the people around me. And this song is kind of like my testimony.
Wasn't for that lighthouse.
that lives around us.
To introduce a welcome rap, Noah.
Just as a point of reference and introduction, I'm Noah's, I'm Glenn's and Craig's brother.
That makes them his uncle. Noah and his brothers and my wife and I live and work at a place called Grottenwood, which is a Christian camp and conference center. And the first meal for the groups that come in, Noah does this rap song. So if everybody would clap with me.
Hey,
my name is Noah Coleman, and I aim to please. I am a new creation. Down on my knees, jump up, turn around, shout out praise. I've got love, joy, peace in all of my days. I came to you because I know I should, to welcome you to Camp Cottonwood.
Stillman is coming to play the organ for us. Stillman. Coming with a dramatic reading. Louise and Justin.
Do I just speak into it?
Well,
What do I do with it?
The first person who needed instruction in the microphone.
My brain is back there with Justin. This was written by John Updike. I don't know if any of you have heard of him. If you have, it's probably in connection with some adult kind of risque novels. But I came across this poem before I was a Christian, when I was in college, and I was an English lit major. And it wasn't until later that it really meant something to me. But I remember when I read it, I thought, this guy really knows what he's talking about. Well, I really think he does now that I'm a Christian and I read it again. It's called Seven Stanzas at Easter. Make no mistake, if he rose at all, it was as his body. If the cell's dissolution did not reverse, the molecules re-knit, the amino acids rekindle, the church will fall. It was not as the flowers, each soft spring recurrent. It was not as his spirit in the mouths and fuddled eyes of the 11 apostles. It was as his flesh, ours. The same hinged thumbs and toes, the same valved heart that pierced, died, withered, paused, and then regathered out of enduring might new strength to enclose. Let us not mock God with metaphor, analogy, sidestepping transcendence, making of the event a parable, a sign painted in the faded credulity of earlier ages. Let's walk through the door. The stone is rolled back, not paper mache, not a stone in a story, but the vast rock of materiality that in the slow grinding of time will eclipse for each of us the wide light of day. And if we will have an angel at the tomb, let's make it a real angel, weighty with Max Planck's quanta, vivid with hair, opaque in the dawn light, robed in real linen and spun on a definite loom. Let us not seek to make it less monstrous for our own convenience, our own sense of beauty, lest, awakened in one unthinkable hour, we are embarrassed by a miracle and crushed by remonstrance.
Our next presentation is for the first time in public anywhere. It's Stephen and Roseanne Brown.
Than when he asked me to marry him.
Yeah.
know, maybe if they show this on Sunday night, you can get $10,000 for it.
One more time.
Our next presentation is a commercial message. Terry Sheldon is bringing us a presentation about love.
I have a question for you tonight. Does God laugh?
No.
Yeah. I think so, especially after some of the things we've seen tonight. That was hysterical. There's a Christian playwright by the name of Richard Erdahl who wrote a play called If He's Not Laughing, It's Not God. And I believe that tonight. And in that spirit, I'd like to offer you a commercial message. from the real sponsor of tonight. Face red, heart thumping, head pounding, fist clench, feel shaky all over. Of all leading preparations for the relief of these symptoms of common anger, 10 out of 10 prefer love. Love is quickest to the bloodstream, speeding relief of those ugly frowns, calms the heart, soothes shaking arms, relieves clenched teeth, and unwinds tight fists. Love will not harm the stomach and has special buffering effect on the vocal cords. In the time that any of these other remedies, bitterness, envy, hate, murder, have only begun to work, love will have completely cured you of all symptoms of anger. Love, it costs a little more, but it lasts forever. Available without prescription, directly from the manufacturer, God. Most effective when taken in a kneeling position. Love, try it the next time anger strikes.
George Fortunato are next. It could be that you came in late and you're preparing or had prepared a musical or poetic or some other dramatic offering for us this evening. If that is true, would you please get word to me now so that we'll be able to fit you into this evening's program. At this time, we'll look to George and Craig.
This is a song we did about a month ago during one of the last snowstorms, and yeah, it was a song that came to me from the Lord that I felt a real closeness to Him, and so I just called it. It's an offering to the Lord, so I call it an offering. We played it during the offering last night. Thank you.
Varghese is coming to read to us from Dorothy Sayers, The Official Doctrine of Christianity. George.
Did you ever feel, when you, like Paul, get up in the morning, that the Bible is dull? That Christianity is a bore? I must confess that sometimes I do. And so it was pleasant for me to be reminded that Christianity is not a bore, it's exciting. And this was something that I read a few weeks ago. It's from a book by Dorothy Sayers called Whimsical Christian, and it's available in the Haverhill Public Library. So I'm going to read to you an English author in an Indian accent to an American audience. The chapter from which it's taken is called The Greatest Drama Ever Staged is the Official Doctrine of Christianity. The central doctrine of Christianity is that Jesus, though he be God and man, is not two, but one Christ. Now this is not a pious commonplace. It's not a commonplace at all. For what it means is this, among other things, that for whatever reason God chose to make man as he is, limited and suffering and subject to sorrows and death, God had the honesty and the courage to take his own medicine. Whatever game he's playing with his creation, he has kept his own rules and played fair. He can exact nothing from man that he has not exacted from himself. He has himself gone through the whole of human experience, from the trivial irritations of family life and the cramping restrictions of hard work and lack of money, to the worst horrors of pain and humiliation, defeat, despair, and death. When he was a man, he played the man. He was born in poverty and died in disgrace and thought it well worthwhile. Now, we may call this doctrine exhilarating, or we may call it devastating, we may call it revelation, or we may call it rubbish. But if we call it dull, then words have no meaning at all. That God should play the tyrant over man is a story familiar from other religions. That man should play the tyrant over man is the usual dreary record of human oppression. But that man should play the tyrant over God and find God a better man than himself is an astonishing drama indeed. Any journalist, the Boston Globe, hearing of it for the first time, would recognize it as news. Those who did hear it for the first time actually called it news. And good news at that. Though we are likely to forget that the word gospel ever, ever meant anything so sensational. Tell this gospel to the unbeliever, though they may not believe it, but at least they may realize that here is something, something that a man may be glad to believe. Thanks.
Ireland and Jess Pedersen singing The Now and the Not Yet.
No longer.
was thinking about joyful noise. Joyful in noise. Now, we have musical noise and noises with voice speaking, but mine is just a plain old joyful noise. And I worked long and hard on this all night last night, trying to think of a nice noise. One that would be joyful. And then I thought of some of my friends and their joyful noises. Like, no, I can't do those. Those are rude joyful noises. So mine is just a plain old joyful noise.
Jessica, I remember Jessica when she was just, well, just real little. And the two of them remind me of myself. I don't get insulted. When I was younger, and thinking how, I don't think we had joyful noises then, joyful noise night, we had a lot of noises back then, but just reminded me that my first time doing a solo in church, I think I was a little bit younger than you were. But you're really fortunate because you had this whole group of people. Well, I had the whole congregation. They were sort of, and I was singing. And my father and my sister and my brother was home on leave. And they were all sitting up at the back of the church being really supportive for me, my first solo in church doing. So it was just so people say, Ruthie, how can you sing in front of people and do, you know, and nothing bothers you? I say, hey, if you had to start, I did, you'd be doing the same thing.
Now we all have problems from time to time, but if we really face them with a faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, there is nothing in this world that we can't handle.
No giant could take him. And Daniel was doomed, but when there was not a wound, when they raised him from the lion's den, Simon Peter in chains brought an angel to the rescue. Paul and Silas in jail were guided to no avail, for the shackles were loosed and the doors just blew open. Now what is the catch, I asked one day I was reading. It must be an age-old mystery. Then taking a second look, I discovered a strikingly clear consistency. Facing disaster face to face, putting God's promises into place, tending to trouble with a little taste. What God can do when His people start calling His name, they anxiously be tested.
Oh, yes, I've found it.
You just trust Him, you'll see. For those who believe, He's still a God of mighty miracles. So when troubles hit hard, turn to God and be patient.
Oh, yes, don't give up, turn to God and
be. Just stand in, don't run, for there isn't anyone that He's ever let down when their lives have been faithful. It's easy to go halfway. So much better off facing disaster face to face. Putting God's promises into place. Tending to trouble with a little taste. What you can do when his people's not calling his name. They anxiously await the power that prayer creates. You gotta know. Take problems that we face, face to face.
Don't know them, they were a very dear couple. And whenever we had a meeting like this, Joyful Noise or a roll call meeting, Marcella would stand up and she might say a little poem, she might not, but she always requested a favorite hymn. And we don't get that anymore. This book is filled with all kinds of wonderful wisdom that sometimes is clouded by the music. So I would like to read you something. Maybe you'll recognize it, maybe you won't, but listen to the wisdom. Be still, my soul. The Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to thy God to order and provide. In every change, he faithful will remain. Be still, my soul. Thy best, thy heavenly friend, through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul. Thy God doth undertake to guide the future as he has the past. Thy hope, thy confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be bright at last. Be still, my soul. The waves and winds still know his voice who ruled them while he dwelt below. Be still, my soul. The hour is hastening on when we shall be forever with the Lord, when disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, sorrow forgot, love's purest joys restored. Be still, my soul. When change and tears are past, all safe and blessed we will meet at last.
Charlie Crook has a song for us. Charlie.
Part of the reason I wanted to do a song tonight for you folks is because
kind of a thank you. I know Ruth Cranton often does songs at my church, and I don't get a chance to do songs here, and yet I feel like most of you, in fact, I feel like all of you are my family. It's been nice to be able to share music with you folks. It's nice to come here and just know people and know that I've got brothers and sisters in Christ and fellow ministers in the gospel. So this is dedicated to God, but it's also dedicated to you folks because it's a happy song. When I wrote it, I call it the language of joy. And we speak the same language. When I come here, I feel like we all speak the language of joy. And unfortunately, not all churches are up to the place where all different types of music can be accepted. I pray and I hope that my church will get to that point. Unfortunately. Yeah. So now, if Ruth had done the song that she just did in front of my congregation on Sunday morning, she'd be facing disaster face to and I'd be out of a job. But I'd be going forward to do the song, and I'm one of the ministers, so hey. But we speak the same language, the language of joy. Toiling, making bricks of mud and straw. He ran away to hide his face from all the pain he saw. But in the desert, Moses found a God whose word was a law. He began to learn the language of joy. When he returned, he led them forth to seek a promised land. They left their foes behind them in the seas beyond the sand. And seeing God had carried them within his mighty hand, he sang out in the language of joy. The language of joy lifts me up when I am down. It gives me strength and courage, it turns my day around. Jesus has taught me to make a brand new sound. I am filled with the language of joy. Jesus on the hillside raised his voice to pray. The people sat in silence to see what he would say. When he called God his Father, well, it made them want to stay. Then he taught to them the language of joy. A dead man heard the cry come forth and stepped out from the gloom. The word was passed around the table in the upper room. Then 3 days later, he is risen, echoed from the tomb. And the world heard the language of joy. The language of joy lifts me up when I am down. It gives me strength and courage, it turns my day around. Jesus has taught me to make a brand new sound. I am filled with the language of joy. Yes, I am filled with his language of joy.
We have two bands presentations that are going to be coming to us in a few moments. I want to make sure that there isn't anyone who was planning to participate who has been overlooked in the programming this evening. If so, you need to speak now or forever hold your peace. I'd like to thank all of you who have participated this evening. All of you have been supportive worshipers in their participation. I think we should give thanks to God and a great offering of applause at this time for all who participated.